Right. So, good morning. Still good morning to everybody here. Morning. No. Kind. Okay. So, my name is Ruth HaCohen, and I'm very pleased and honored to preside over this session now. This particular session turns from the sciences to the humanities. I mean, we were in the humanities as well beforehand as a critique of the sciences. And more particularly, we are going in terms of the discipline, this is what we are doing today, to aesthetics. And to the critique of aesthetics in relation to secularization, I assume. I was also asked to give the response to Professor Menninghaus' talk. This is a very efficient sort of symposium today, which I was pleased to accept as well. Like Avishai Margalit yesterday, let me say a few words, and also I saw that Jürgen did the same. A few words before I talk, that is before introducing our speaker, Professor Winfried Menninghaus. So like the former speakers, I want to say a few personal words to Gabi, an old and dear friend, and I can boast that I know you more than 30 years. In the 10 years of his tenure here, I was very busy at the university in all sorts of roles, so I could see and watch your activities here a bit from kind of distance, although we collaborated on some very important projects. But I can attest even more from a more closer perspective for what Gabi did previously as the dean of the Faculty of the Humanities at the Hebrew University. He changed the culture of the faculty for the better, especially the hiring system, and his legacy, I can assure you, is still strong with us. I'm sure that also your legacy here, Gabi, will stand for many years to come. One of which is the unique way in which you open so many conferences, lectures, and so on. You're starting with, my name is Gabriel Motzkin, and I'm the director of the, and so on. But what follows, this is the most important thing. Always pertinent, spoken from within a broad perspective that carries with it a special insight and sheds light on the ensuing discussions. Gabi, I wish you and Emily many years of good health, productivity, and many wonderful intellectual insights, and much, much joy. And now for Professor Winfried Menninghaus, who, like our former speaker, is a Max Planck senior researcher, this time the Max Planck Institute on Empirical Aesthetics, and you will understand what it is very soon, in Frankfurt, where he acts as a director of language and literature since 2013. Beforehand, he was the director of the interdisciplinary research cluster Languages of Emotions at Freie Universität Berlin. Professor Menninghaus had many visiting positions in Paris and the United States, some of which you have declined. Professor Menninghaus studied philosophy, German language, and literature at the universities of Marburg and Heidelberg. Of his numerous publications, many of which especially recently co-authored with a few other scholars from different disciplines, let me mention a few of those written by you as a sole writer. They include, and look and listen to the titles, The Promise of Beauty of 2003, Ekel, Disgust of 2002, that was translated, I was told, five languages, Lob des Unsinns, in praise of nonsense, of 1995, and more recently, Wort zur Kunst, that was translated as What is Art for Aesthetics? What is it? After Darwin. But what is important is aesthetics, what is art? Aesthetics after Darwin. Okay, something like that. So Professor Menninghaus, you are cordially invited.
Well, thank you very much for your introduction. Well, first of all, dear Gabi, dear Emily, it's also my great pleasure to be here on the occasion of this farewell colloquium. Now, I mean, much has already been said about your achievements, about your work. I would like to add only one thing that relates to my talk. So whenever I met you, I took great pleasure in your verbal eloquence as combined with a high precision and with the classical rhetorical virtues of liveliness and of engaging the people who listen to you. And actually, you know, we have recently developed a statistical algorithm for measuring the aesthetic appeal of longer trajectories of a spoken utterance. Or using Aristotle's, you know, term, you are a master of the grand period. And you know, you all witnessed an example of that this morning. So in your response, so it went on and had a very nice tension resolution structure, so which you can analyze with the tools of musical analysis. And, you know, it never lost track, so it went on and on. So my wish for you, I mean, I join another speaker in the wish that you keep daring to know, but I also wish you to keep speak in that, you know, very unique, profound, and beautiful way. So now, so I'm a literary scholar, and I've worked as a classical humanistic literary scholar for 30 years before venturing into cooperations with the sciences. Now, what is underlying, I mean, this new project is a sense on my part that many things can't be dealt with using the classical, you know, methods of the humanist readings of texts. Specifically, we cannot really know how they act on the minds and the brains and the bodies of readers. And what I will present you today is a model of poetic language that we are working on, along with a number of studies that have empirically investigated the actual effects on of specific dimensions of this model. Now, one more remark before I actually start. Efforts to understand poetic language in linguistics, you know, have completely given up by the 1960s. Unfortunately, there is no longer any cooperation between modern linguistics and literary scholarship. So as a result, I mean, scientific poetics has ceased to be in place. It's never really thrived. And when it comes to empirical aesthetics, I mean, the studies of music and visual aesthetics are thriving throughout the world. But that is not true for poetic and rhetorical language use. For some reason, it's not on the agenda. And you know, and because this is the case, it's a science in its infancies. And I will present you some preliminary findings today. Now, I will sketch you a theoretical model of poetic language as we develop it right now. I will present a study using proverbs as a test case. I mean, that's, for me, hilarious. I've written books on Celan Hölderlin, now all of a sudden I study proverbs. It's very trivial stuff, but it's nice to investigate scientifically. I will then present a study that actually luckily has been accepted yesterday by a science journal as one of the first major papers on poetry to be actually published in the science world. That's the third thing. And finally, I will present something on goosebumps and chills and what we can learn through these responses of our bodies about poetry. Now I start with where actually scientific poetics stopped. That's Jacobson, 1960. He made a courageous claim saying the structure of poetic language consists of patterns of ongoing parallelism. That was truly a fairly novel claim. And unfortunately there was no follow-up. No one has actually taken it up. We will try to take this up. What does parallelistic patterning mean? I will give you an example soon. It includes all linguistically non-mandatory, yet perceptually salient features of recurrence across all levels of text. phonology, prosody, syntax, morphology, semantics. So it's really highly multidimensional. And I can give you a very, very simple example first. I mean, east or west, home is best. I mean, everyone senses right away this is highly parallelistic. I mean, it's more difficult to detect in other cases, but I can tell you, I mean, this thing works virtually everywhere. Here you see first and last words of the syntactic groups rhyme. Best, we see an equal length of prosodic cola, three syllables, and not to forget, there is a metrical structure, the so-called criticus, meaning one stressed syllable followed by an unstressed one and a second stressed one, east or west. Home is best. That's frequently used even in German proverbs, like, for instance, Ende gut, alles gut, and the like. I mean, it's actually also heavily in use in English. And you see it identical total number, grouping of phonemes, and you see, which is quite important, equal word morphology of the cola. It's all monosyllabic words. Now, in order to make sure we are not experts on proverb research only, I bring up a verse by Shakespeare here. Well, who feels confident to pronounce that in an appropriate Elizabethan English? I don't, you know, but whatever. I mean, let me just speak it as though it was modern American, whatever. All days are nights to see till I see thee. So, I mean, this is an abbreviated version of the parallelistic analysis. Obviously, it features ongoing iambic meter. Again, like in many of the most memorable verses by Shakespeare, completely monosyllabic verse. All words have four or less phonemes. The word C is repeated. I mean, I don't actually want to go to the end. You see what I mean. And I can tell you, I mean, if you analyze a single stanza by Shakespeare along these lines, you end up with 50 through 100 parallelistic patterns. So that's quite a powerful thing. It's a dense web of parallelistic patterning superimposed on ordinary language. Now, I mean, so there is a historical and philosophical background that I think might be interesting here of the parallelism hypothesis. Actually, it was first discussed by the middle of the 18th century in Bible criticism. So Robert Loth wrote a famous Oxford dissertation, which he kind of, to some extent, also wondered, I mean, why there are so many repetitions in the Old Testament. And this triggered an entire discourse on, I mean, why biblical language, ritual language, poetic language is so much shaped through repetitive structures. And in fact, the German authors, Johann Gottfried Herder and Friedrich Schlegel, joined in. Herder brought up the notion that might reflect the origin of language or of ritual language in dance, song, and you know, other ways of social practice. Friedrich Schlegel now was the person who used to turn that into a rigid philosophical framework. In fact, he drew on Kant and Fichte, and you turned the notion of parallelism into the notion of ongoing systems of mirrors that are reflected through our texts. And it's the notion of self-reflection. So in this case, so Schlegel was the philosopher to turn the poetic discourse on parallelism into a elaborate thought of self-reflection. And, you know, I mean, one of my great heroes of thought, Walter Benjamin, actually wrote his dissertation about this very thing. So to some extent, therefore, what I'm talking about also has to do with 18th century poetics, has to do with Romanticism, it has to do with Walter Benjamin. Now, parallelistic factors or structures consist, obviously, of patterns of recurrence. Call them symmetry, self-reference, self-similarity. And so these features of diction bestow a higher than usual perceptual rhythmicity on sentences, and they render them more self-contained and richer in elution. Now, in these patterns, actually, because it's all about recurrence, allow for a direct comparison with analogous features known to support perceived beauty in both music and the visual domain. And in fact, so we now use actually statistical tools for music research in order to statistically analyze parallelistic patterns. Now, this is now our measure for parallelistic diction. It would take me a day or so to reveal the underlying secrets, but it's not yet published, so I won't tell you all the details. But essentially, it's a measure of the density, of parallelistic patterns per syllable. So we analyze everything, each individual feature of parallelism, and then we sum them up and divide them by the total number of syllables. It's a reductive statistical measure, meaning it assumes it is a continuous measure. Obviously, in aesthetics, nothing is continuous, but statistical measures have to make a compromise. And so that's what we did. Now, there's a second factor important for our model, and that is deviations from linguistic rules, such as those that were already called poetic license by the ancient rhetorician Quintilian. Those features include the invention of novel words, they include the ellipsis of expectable phonemes and sentence parts, and many other features. All these features converge in violating expectations of word form and or syntactic order. Here, the same example. The sentence "East or West times best" omits multiple expectable sentence parts that you would expect. The full version would be, whether it's located in the East or West, one's own home is always the best place to be. Obviously, that would be a very boring sentence, but that is fully correct. Now, I can tell you, after going through quite a number of poems, virtually each line of poetry features at least one such feature of poetic license. Remember the Shakespeare verse? That's, by the way, detectable for each and every one of you. If you read the sentence, "all days are," and then ask people what would be the next words, no one would say nights. So the likelihood of the word nights to appear after the three words "all days are" is very low. So, and that is a strong statistical effect, because we are probabilistic thinker and we anticipate the words to come. And here now, so we are clearly surprised to hear "all days are nights." And then actually, even the continuation, if you have swallowed the sentence "all days are nights," you would still not be able to predict the continuation to see. It's almost impossible. So this is, we have developed a statistical way to account for the graded difficulty of continuing a sentence. So that is our second factor then. And I will briefly give you an idea of what that does. Now, one theoretical background is taken from current neuroscience, according to which our brain is a predictive coding machine, which is trivial. To some extent, we consistently predict the next move of a speaker or the next thing to happen here and there. So, and we, based on what we have experienced, we always anticipate the next thing. And now, parallelistic features of the type I've described provide more order than expected, and they are hence positive prediction errors. So getting a rhyme, getting consistent meter, is kind of let you jump on the train, it's easy going. So there is a pattern that's repeated. At the opposite end, and we have actually shown that in a neuroscientific study that's been published here in Cognitive Affective Behavior Neuroscience, that if you only focus on the parallelistic features, then it means your brain needs less effort to understand the sentence or to swallow it one way or another. Even if it's not really understandable, it's prosodically so persuasive that it reduces your effort. There's overwhelming evidence that this experience predicts beauty attributions. So because it's easygoing, you are inclined to feel that is a beautiful sentence. But on the other hand, features of poetic license provide less order than expected. And hence, they constitute what is called negative prediction errors in line with the predictive coding hypothesis, typically as measured by the so-called N400 response. So it's readily detectable in the brain signal. If you run, come across one such thing, then your N400, you know, gets up. And now, intriguingly, thus parallelistic hyperorder and poetically licensed hyperorder routinely co-occur not only in the same sentences, but even in the very same words. That's a nightmare for experimental research. That's why it's never been used, actually, because you need to dissociate all phenomena, and it's not quite easily done. But I think you get the point. So what we have in poetic and rhetorical language use is a combination of opposite features. The ones making it easier, the others making it more difficult, and they rely on different brain structures and different mechanisms, are engaged in reading, hearing these things. Now, interestingly, each of these two separate factors already alone enhance memorability. So, I mean, that means if you get a cocktail of the two, I can tell you, I mean, almost all, we can readily predict the most successful commercial ads with this model in no time. That's, I mean, far easier than going through poetry, but I haven't done it yet. I mean, I it's clearly doable. Now, I mean, I just mentioned there's a third factor which we have not looked into yet before I go to the empirical work. Now, obviously, poetic imagery is an important factor of rhetorical diction. Typically, most people think then of metaphor, but also metonymy and other mostly semantic figures and tropes of diction. Now, this factor has attracted by far greatest attention in scientific research over the last decades, specifically cognitive metaphor research. It has not really been carried out, this research, with a focus on aesthetic values and aesthetic perception, but still, I mean, so we felt like now starting this research, we focus on those things that have not been looked at. And that is actually the first two factors. And for the remainder of my talk, therefore, I will only speak about these two factors. Now, as I said, Jakobson has brought up this issue of parallelism, and there was no follow-up. But even in the way he brought it up in a famous MIT lecture, there is a number of things that, unfortunately, he left us to do. And that is, I mean, he does not say anything about the potential effects of parallelistic patterning on aesthetic perception. So, I mean, I will, on aesthetic perception that might be supported by that patterning. Second, the hypothesis does not consider potential effects of parallelistic diction on emotional processing. And that's another key focus of our work, the emotional effects of poetic language. Third, he at some point he says he believes that parallelistic patterning makes a sentence more ambiguous. So it is the hypothesis, it should make the processing semantically more demanding. But something, again, Jakobson was a theoretical linguist. He never tested the hypothesis. He also completely disregarded the poetic license factor and other factors. And finally, obviously, I mean, he was not interested in developing a quantitative matrix that measures how parallelistic or how violating a text is. And now I present you the first study we have performed. On that issue, I mean, we did not use East or West, home is best. I didn't find a better example. Obviously, we used German 19th century proverbs, like Planeten sind übel Propheten. I don't know how many of you speak any German here. And so what was the idea? So the rhetorical target features were what is called the virtue of brevitas, very succinct message. Typically, succinctness comes at the expense of the full linguistic form. And rhyme and meter were the others, were the other things. And here in all the items we used, in all the proverbs we used, we had both rhyme and meter and rhetorical brevitas. And rhetorical brevitas was defined as complete absence of three of the six features you see there. Either three of those six need to be absent in order for our criteria to be met. Now, what did we find? Now, that means we had a nice manipulation. There you see the rhetorical features. East or west home is best. I mean, without rhyme, it's then north or south home is best. And if you take out meter and brevitas, it's whether it's in the east or west, one's own home is always the best. And if we then additionally take out the rhyming thing, it's whether it's in the north or south, one's own home is always the best. I mean, in the German variants, the difference in length is not as pronounced as it's here. I had to improvise something, right? So, I mean, and again, those were unfamiliar proverbs because familiarity is a major predictor of perceptions. They were taken from 18th century and 19th century collections, and they were actually rated as being unknown. So, in fact, what we investigated was not proverbs, but sentences that feature, I mean, the rhetorical virtues of proverbs. Now, first of all, that is what our test of Jakobson's hypothesis. Yes, we did find Jakobson was right. This is, I mean, this represents the version without all rhetorical features. I mean, the lengthy one without rhyme, without meter. And that is significantly easier to understand. That means comprehensibility is higher for those than all other that involve rhetorical features. It doesn't look like it's a gigantic effect, but it's highly significant. So we did find Jakobson's, anticipation was correct in this regard. Now, getting to more positive things. Now, whenever you perform empirical research and measure something, obviously the most important thing is to think about what you will measure. And in most cases in aesthetics research, it's just beauty. And you know, believe it or not, so we are the first to actually use a pregnance scale, which is, I mean, around in visual aesthetics for a while. It's a law of pregnance. It's even in English the German word, but it's readily translatable as succinctness. And so what we did find then is a very strong pregnance effect. I mean, not surprisingly so, given the nature of the sentence. But this is, I mean, something you need to really show in order to develop a model. And so, as it turns out, both the use of the rhyme and the meter brevitas thing enhances the succinctness of pregnance. And now, I mean, you see what our statistical measure can do. So the dots are the individual proverbs. The red dots are the original ones. The blue ones are those without rhyme, meter, and everything. And what you see is our statistical measure for the individual sentences self-similarity predicts the ratings to a surprisingly high degree. So that you see it's clearly a gradation, almost an ideal line here. So we were obviously very fond. Our nice statistics, you know, has the power to predict subjective ratings of those sentences. Now the beauty effect is less pronounced than the pregnance effect, but it's the same thing. So if you add rhetorical charms, you get a higher rating for beauty. Now, I mean, now comes a more tricky, more problematic aspect of rhetoric, which is well known ever since Plato's critique of rhetoric. Here we asked, I mean, which sentence would you use for persuasive purposes? If you want to, like, that's a typical use of proverbs, I mean, you want to make someone act in a specific way. And now it turns out this is the sentence without any rhetorical feature. It ended up higher in power of persuasion than the proverb version with rhyme only or with meter only. So that was something we did not really expect. But we did also not expect what comes next. If those two join forces, wow. So that is an impressive interaction effect. So once the two features are conjointly applied, you have a very strong turnaround. So that's actually, there is a theory in it's inverted U-shape, so it's not a linear curve, but it is a non-linear effect. And whenever you deal with with multiple components underlying an effect, you can count on non-linearity, which is why it's so difficult to predict the effect. But here, across the 30 proverbs, we did find a strong, I mean, a powerful turnaround effect. So that is, as a result, the very sentences that are least easy to comprehend were rated as being most persuasive. So, I mean, that's obviously what Plato always despised about rhetoric, that it makes you believe even false statements. And to some extent, so it's also reproved to some extent Plato's hypothesis. And, you know, we are not endorsing it, right? We are not endorsing it, but it's simply clearly a very clear result of this research. Now, what did we find? Now, obviously, parallelistic patterning of sentences, of a sentence's phonological and morphological shape, combined with the linguistic violation patterns promoting brevitas and enhance perceived beauty, strikingness, and power of persuasion, even while reducing ease of conceptual or semantic processing. And we did find strong interaction effects, as predicted by the founding figure of empirical aesthetics, Gustav Theodor Fechner. He has already an entire section on Wechselwirkung. Interaktionseffekte are, I mean, difficult to model in terms statistically, and but they are very powerful. Now I move to the second block of my presentation. Here, the goal will be to introduce the category of being moved, and then to show how the powers of poetic diction influence our responses of being emotionally moved. Now, I'm also a classicist in that I have not only gone through 9 years of Latin and Greek and in school, but also it was one of my topics in teaching. You know, in Latin rhetoric, you find the notion of movere for the first time, and ever since then, it's around throughout poetics and aesthetics that the arts strive to emotionally move the audience. I mean, that's obvious even until today's, you know, ads for a deeply moving film, a highly moving novel. In the New York Times, to find it each other day or so. I mean, the word is still in use. But there's something intriguing about the category of being moved, in that it never was listed on an emotion catalog, neither in antiquity nor in modernity. And in fact, it was not researched. It wasn't clear what it actually means. So is it actually an emotion at all? Because it's derived from the Latin word movere, or does it simply mean each type of emotion? I mean, that is highly unlikely given the fact that many, many languages, in fact, all I looked into, have developed a separate term for being emotionally moved. But the emotional profile of this emotion is far from known. And in order for us to perform empirical studies, we needed to have a clear concept or a construct of what emotionally moving means. And in fact, that took us some 3 years or so. First of all, I give you two examples, and that should already offer you a picture of what emotionally moving scenarios are. So essentially, through a number of empirical studies, we arrived at the conclusion that there's two basic variants of being emotionally moved. The one being the sadly moving variant. And in this case, experiences of loss, such as separation, a couple separating, a marriage falling apart, or even cases of death, are blended with a positive appreciation of the value and of the memory of a beloved, and or with feelings of love or empathy on the part of bystanders and onlookers. Just to give you one example, again, a statistical one. If you look at the highest number of entries for being moved in the media over the past 10 years, it's two occasions: Lady Di's funeral and Nelson Mandela's funeral. So, in both cases, you have strong experiences of sadness, but on the occasion of the funeral, the positive feelings, directed at those persons are brought up, and a sense of connection to them is established. So to some extent, therefore, we arrived at the conclusion that being moved can integrate the feeling of sadness into a altogether positive thing. So like honoring something, feeling pro-social feelings towards some person, but also the beauty of the funeral itself can contribute to that. As it means rituals can be emotionally moving for that very reason. Now the joyfully moving variant, is the opposite to some extent, but actually not entirely the opposite, because it blends positive feelings with some discrete negative counterparts, such, for instance, as an awareness that a happy reunion was preceded by a painful period of separation. So happy reunion after a divorce of a couple, someone confesses his transgressions or whatever sins, and they are together again. So that is emotionally moving, not only because it's a happy end, but because your feeling integrates the preceding period of separation into the overall emotional response. Now, this is the construct we presented a year ago in the Journal Plus One, and that's for the time being our most highly quoted paper, because we actually brought coming from the background of poetics, emotional state everyone knows to the attention of the sciences. So it does tell you the eliciting events, often critical life events such as death, birth, significant relationship events, political events also. For time reasons, I can't go through everything. Here, the important feeling qualities, the phenomenological feeling qualities, it feels rather wide than narrow, feels rather warm than cold, rather large than small, which is why it's also related to the feelings of the sublime, and rather soft than hard. Those are things many people believe can be measured by statistical measures, but in fact, quantitative measures are very good in identifying phenomenological qualities and qualia of a feeling. To some extent, there is something about the promotion of social bonds and feelings of being moved, which is why, they are often also related to national anthems, for instance. So, and people are being moved, or even, winning a gold medal can, trigger this feeling. And there are quite a number of different things. I think it's a really rich emotional state, completely unstudied in the sciences for a simple reason, because, in the Western languages, the emotion doesn't come as a noun. And the list only includes, emotional list includes only noun. So that is, it's called the lack of prototypicality of the emotion. It comes in complex, terms. Now, what did we do? So we collected, we wanted to study the emotional effects, and specifically the effects in terms of being moved, in terms of being sadly moved, in terms of being joyfully moved, as a function of what I have presented as the parallelistic patterning of poetic diction. So to this end, we collected 20 sadly and 20 joyfully moving poems from later 18th to mid-century, and quite a variety, written by 33 authors. No famous poems included. They all had to be unknown. It's painful, but the most beautiful poems are not useful for this type of research. We identified all the parallelistic patterns and then carefully rewrote the poems. Took us months. We had a poet involved and everything. These texts still should look like poems. So we took out quite a variety of the parallelistic patterns. And then we wanted to find out to what extent the following variables are affected by our experimental modulation. The liking rating, the sadness rating, the joy rating, the being moved rating, the intensity of emotional involvement, and two measures, positive and negative affect, that relate to the circumplex model of emotional responses, according to which each emotional response can be at least projected onto the distinction of positive versus negative affect on a valence axis. I don't really want to go into these details because too many of you will not be able to follow me. So this took us really quite a while, but I jumped to the results. And what you see is, as a result of the taking out of the parallelistic target features, virtually all ratings go very significantly down. Thereby, proving our hypothesis or Jakobson's hypothesis that parallelistic diction is of major importance for poetic and rhetorical language that applies here to liking, to beautiful melodiousness, moving, but also to felt joy, felt sadness, positive feelings go down, negative feelings, that's here not a significant difference. That's not much of a difference with regard to negative feelings. But look at one thing, and I will get back to that later. Here, in the modified version, felt sadness goes down, meaning the parallelistic patterning makes you feel more sad about what is represented. But if felt sadness goes down, then you could expect positive feelings should go up, but they don't. But they go, so that is, positive feelings and felt sadness correlates positively. So, and we have, meanwhile, abundant evidence that in many cases of music and poetry, attribution of sadness to a piece of music enhances your positive feelings. So, I mean, to some extent, this is something is another major topic of our research, the enjoyment of negative emotions in the arts, which is around ever since Aristotle's theory of tragedy. And we will soon publish a comprehensive model on how we can understand that. I just bring it up here so you see, I mean, these ratings here are surprisingly, precise, and they offer a high granularity of analysis for our purposes. And again, this is, what our statistical measure does. It does nicely predict those. That's really good for the next step is going to be neuroscientific research, but then you have two regressors. The regressors are the ratings and the statistical measure you have developed. That's a very powerful tool then to look into brain activation patterns. And now what we find is the inherently rewarding nature of being moved by an artwork is in fact strongly sensitive, as predicted by Horace, Quintilian, Cicero, to formal dimensions of its making. And the parallelistic features now surprisingly equally serve higher degrees of joy and higher degrees of sadness. And so that is, they serve as generalized intensifiers of both emotional impact and aesthetic appreciation, regardless of whether the key emotional content of the poems was sad or joyful. And in fact, in the previous study, we had already shown that the very same features using Wilhelm Busch verses, couplets, also can enhance feelings of wit, funniness, and humor. So to some extent, they are all-purpose tools. To some extent, that's something Aristotle hints at some point, because he was reluctant to attribute any specific, effect, for instance, to meter, because dependent on the context and the way meter is handled, there's actually the handling of meter also is different, even if you say it's iambic. Iambic verse by Wilhelm Busch is completely different from iambic verse by Shakespeare. That's mostly disregarded. But here we can say, parallelistic features have shown to do all sorts of things. And which is why, as of now, we feel, they really are powerful, they are a powerful factor of poetic and rhetorical language use. And I can tell you, we have now measured that also in auditory presentations. You can then feed those audio files into computerized programs and then analyze them using a variety of statistical tools. And it really gives you striking results about what happens through the poetic refinement of a sentence, of an entire period and everything. Now, I think, this model we have developed will have high potential for also historical research. Because, we are talking about something like 200 features of parallelism we have identified and we measure in our tool. And we only start now a computerized automatic analysis of those features. It's going to take us a while, but once we have managed to do this, we can analyze entire corpora and then identify whether or not a specific literary period, for instance, focuses primarily on syntactic parallelism or on phonological parallelism or semantic parallelism. So that can give you, in the end, distinct profiles for individual authors, specific periods, and perhaps even historical epochs. You know, I'm dreaming to some extent because, you know, it's easily told, but it's really time-consuming. So very downside about empirical work is, you know, I could write my books way faster than finishing one of those studies. Now, finally, final thing. Now, this is now a different methodology I will present you. Again, we used emotionally moving poems, but in this case, you know, we wanted to go beyond ratings. And there is a well-established paradigm in the neuroscientific research on music, dating back to 2001, where the Canadian researchers Blatt and Zatora is in fact established to some extent a research paradigm that ever since has become very important for research on aesthetic responses. I mean, their underlying notion was, it's not really meaningful when it comes, say, to poems, for instance. Few people read poems anymore today. To present, say, randomly, you know, selected readers to a poem by Hölderlin. I wouldn't do that, actually. It's really, for me, it strikes me as meaningless. But they said, if you want to learn more about the response, ask the participants to bring their favorite poems to the lab and have them read it and then record all their responses. So the downside is you don't learn anything about the poem because everyone uses a different poem. So there's no way to generalize over the responses. And we tried to overcome that in that we combined this paradigm, so bring your own favorite poem to the lab, in that we also presented all participants with 5 poems that we had selected in order to find out something about the potential generalizability of the findings based on object properties. So that's what the underlying idea was. Now, first of all, I mean, we knew already from previous study that something that was not noticed in the research on chills, namely that they are highly dependent on emotional states of being moved. So I don't know to what extent you have a recollection of when you experience chills, shivers down the spine, or goosebumps. But typically, if you have not been sensitized to it, you mostly you're not aware of it. But you know, and I was one such person that I thought, wow, this is a very infrequent thing. It's actually not. So experience sampling studies have shown that people routinely experience, chills each week, more than once each week. And in fact, the number of chills we have measured in the lab is really astounding. So it continues our research on being moved because, as I said, so that is a predictor. The being moved line here predicts the occurrence of chills. As you see, it's very strong. And intriguingly, sadness is a stronger predictor than joy. So it's more profoundly and more frequently you will experience chills if it is of the sadly moving variants. Now, having said that, I jump to the design. So yeah, that is one of the here. Those coming to our lab brought their own poems, right? And we put the audio file. I mean, they brought their own poems in audio files. That's important for the design. I should say As a literary scholar, I was, first of all, not really happy with using audio files. But I then asked the participants of a class, a poetry class of mine I gave in Berlin at that time, how many of those who were voluntarily attending this class and were, I mean, professed amateurs of poetry, would rather read or listen. 60%, you know, indicated that they listened to their favorite renditions of these things. So reading as a cultural technique is receding to some extent. But for experimental purposes, it's far better to have an auditory file, because you can track then the temporal trajectory, I mean, at the millisecond. You wouldn't really know how fast someone reads silently. Now, so what did we take? The measures we took, I mean, as blood volume pulse here with the sensor on the finger, skin conductance measure is a measure that indicates degree of emotional arousal fairly significantly. Respiration activity was measured. And this is something, I mean, we were the first to apply in this context. That's facial EMG, electromyographic responses of the face. There's two muscles in the face that indicate your positive and negative affect. The smiling muscle is here. I mean, if that is activated, you feel positive affect. And this way, this is the frowning muscle. And importantly, those muscles are always active. So that is even without someone showing some visible difference, you can still measure his or her positive and negative affect fairly reliably. So and the good thing about this measure is it can only give you mixed effect. So that is, someone can have high positive and high negative measure, something that was around in aesthetics in 18th century, but that has been rediscovered in psychological research only in the 1990s. Ever since then, models of mixed effect have been brought up that are far better fit with aesthetics than our classical models, where there is an alternative between either positive or negative. And the most fancy thing is this one, goosebumps. So we mounted a goosebumps camera on the forearm of the participants, and so that is, we would have objectively measured goosebumps and time-locked. So that's, I mean, obviously, it's important. You know, for me, that was hilarious fun. You know, you can imagine, as a literary scholar, doing this type of thing. I still love it. And I will now present you a slide on which you see all these measures along with hearing the poem that has been recited. So you see all these data now going and I use a poem by Eichendorff, a Trennung. So it's a sad poem about divorce, right? And now, I mean, obviously, even if you don't listen to it, just look at the activity that's popping up. I mean, for, let's see how it works. Seems like. Could you make it a little louder? What? This morning was far better. Oh.
Nach ihm trachten. Er mag der lauernden Gefahr.
You see the goosebumps here? See the
Tod der schon im öden Herzen.
This is the negative corrugator muscle. I mean, all these others.
Du die Mutter auch belogst, betrübtest, was andere Leute drüber deuten, sagen, sonst scheu.
It doesn't really work.
Sich zeigen, wie du. Gabst du ins Feld mir schweigen?
This is just.
Okay, so that was it. Now I mean, you know,
I can only give you a commentary on a few of the results we obtained. Now, first of all, so in this case, I only show you the results for those periods which are called peak emotional responses. That is, people have goosebumps. Oh, sorry. So, yeah. I will only offer a few, you know, peak views on those results. What you can see here, if there is a chill response or a goosebumps response, it unfolds over the trajectory of 3 seconds, typically. This is onset period. So as a result, what you see here is the difference between the pre-goose, the control means the pre-goosebumps state, and the goosebump state. So here, for instance, in terms of the corrugator activity, that's the negative muscle. So, you know, the thing is, importantly, there is agreement that chills and goosebumps in response to artworks are highly pleasurable. So that is something, that's a trigger, a very strong release of the reward system. And I will get back to that later. But what we found is at the same time, they have a very strong activity of the negative muscle. So indicating, I mean, as I said, the mixed effect thing. And so our model actually predicts that artworks that use mixed affective messages are far more powerful than those exclusively focusing on positive things. And the same applies to skin conductance. I mean, there's a strong, I mean, that's amazing what's going on underneath the skin and on the skin while reading a poem. And in fact, over the course of our study, we measured, believe it or not, 1,600 chill epochs. And it's, I had never, you know, believed that this would be possible. And now, I give you another measure. I'm approaching the conclusion. I mean, you see a so-called heat map of a single poem, and the more red it gets, the higher the likelihood that people experienced chills. And it tells you something that again is around ever since Aristotle, and that is the fact we see a closure or a cadence effect on three levels. I mean, the highest likelihood of occurrence is near the very end of the poem. And then again, within a line, it's also, or within a stanza, that's also the final position, and within a single line. And I mean, the very end of Aristotle's rhetoric is about the power of the cadences. And that's an elaborate chapter of Quintilian's rhetoric. And to some extent here, so what we see is cadence structure as analyzed by classical rhetoric, in fact, predict the strongest emotional responses we measured in this context. I have a final slide, and I need to be very brief on that because I'm not a neuroscientist, but that was a neuroscientific study. That is, all these poems were also read while lying in the scanner, and the people experienced the chills and the goosebumps in the scanner. So that we were able to actually collect brain data. And, you know, I do not feel competent to give a detailed reading, but there's one thing, a few things I can say. Now, first of all, it turns out that reading poetry recruits, in fact, the most deep-seated brain structures of reward. So it's the so-called primary reward network. So, I mean, that is not trivial because many people would feel it would be more related to, say, more symbolic reward network. We found no overlap with a symbolic reward network. We found a strong overlap, believe it or not, with the reward network for sexual reward and food reward. So the most originary, strongest things. I mean, it will be, now I should say, we will not, report this finding in the study, because there's one thing about, you know, scientific research of this type I'm not willing to accept. If we wanted now to to present those findings, the ones I just mentioned, to a journal, they would ask us to show that the overlap applies to the very same persons. So our data were for persons reading poetry, and the other were for persons eating in the scanner, and even, believe it or not, I mean, having literally sex in the scanner. The brains were measured. So the classical requirement would be, if you really want to show poetry has the same, you need to have the same persons, we would need to ask the readers to, well, obviously that's way beyond what I can imagine as a literary scholar. It's a funny involvement of this type of research, but there's still enough stuff to be reported as a result of the study. But for the time being, I thank you for your patience and bring up the persons who cooperate with me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Menninghaus. So now I'm also turning into my job as a respondent to this highly interesting lecture. What is and what does poetical language, Menninghaus asks, paying tribute to Aristotle's Poetics from beginning to end, as you heard just now, as the actual founder of the larger field of aesthetics, beyond this or that literary genres, which Aristotle's famous treatise discusses, of course, the tragedy. A sub-discipline of philosophy, aesthetics has also been, in the last 2.5 millennia, a cross-disciplinary intellectual pursuit, interacting in various ways with the distinct bodies of knowledge associated with various art forms. One of the most remarkable features of the history of this subdiscipline that evolved in large leaps of time, this is somehow related to Jürgen's lecture that we heard in the morning, is that each stage of development incorporated to a considerable degree its important antecedents rather than restarting from scratch. This was pivotal for the most renowned and important rebirth of the field in the 18th century, that also christened it aesthetics, of course, by Alexander Baumgarten, you know it very well. As part of the larger enterprise of the Enlightenment, it embodied secularization in various ways, the most crucial of which was turning top-down Neoplatonic aesthetic paradigms for bottom-up Aristotelian ones. This meant primarily viewing each art form as distinct sense formation, pictorial or oral, linguistic, so and so forth, lingual, ending up in different modes of experience and ideation. The theoretical and practical consequences of this turn were far-reaching for the systematization of the field and the appreciation of different artworks. The current stage of experimental aesthetics and neuroaesthetics, to which you referred in the third part of your talk, practiced by Professor Menninghaus and his colleagues, materialized the basic orientation to a greater degree. As it asks or seeks to further dissect the experimental components and connect them. You saw it only briefly, but the stuff that I read, it had more than that, to brain matters in the attempt to pin down the unique processes that comprise aesthetic cognition. I find it praiseworthy, highly praiseworthy, I would say even, that like their predecessors in aesthetics, these researchers, led by you, as I understand, constantly refer to the traditions from which they accept the basic notions in which they further consult for analyzing the problems they investigate. In the following, I will refer to this dialogue between traditional and experimental aesthetics briefly pinpointing the contribution of the current approach, your approach, to the general body of knowledge of art theory, as well as some inherent limitations. The three interrelated elements I will discuss in this regard concern, one, what distinguishes poetic or aesthetic, for that matter, mental processes from non-aesthetic, though neighboring ones. Second, the tension between the normative and the descriptive in art theory as reflected in lay versus informed experience of art. The third, the role of judgment and intellection in experiencing art. Referring to the first element, Menninghaus and colleagues expectedly hypothesize that what distinguishes poetic or aesthetic mental processes would reveal itself in different organization or hierarchies of quotidian mental operations, rather than in activities unique to the aesthetic realm. That's taken almost for granted. For example, dissecting parameters of poetic perception, I'm very glad that you brought this particular study, I didn't know what you are going to bring, about the German proverbs by native speakers in terms of meter, rhyme, and succinctness, and you saw that. These scholars experimentally weighed the price paid for the predominance of these prosodic elements over semantic comprehension of these proverbs. Unsurprisingly, they found out that such literary phrases are less intelligible than less prosodically cohesive ones, which are more user-friendly syntactically or even semantically. The findings led them to surmise, and this is something that you haven't mentioned, I found very, very interesting, that the greater cognitive challenges in grasping poetic phrases, cognitive from the point of view of the meaning of them, not from the prosodic point of view, may contribute to a more profound semantic understanding of the message these proverbs entail, rather than the block their comprehension. That is to say, in the East and West, home is best, because of the fact you have to make more efforts in order to grasp what it is, you will go deeper into the meaning of what it means that home is best than all what you see around the world. Aesthetic satisfaction, in other words, encourages, as we learn from this, a deeper hermeneutical delving into abstruse poetical messages. The emotions, now another thing, which is related to the same first element that I'm discussing, the emotional category of being moved, also we heard about that, characterizes the experience of music, and you mentioned it, and other fictional artistic stimuli, but is no less prevalent in biographical life events and in media representing real events, as you mentioned in one of your articles. In all cases, the studies reveal specific mixtures of sadness and joy that are major characteristic of this marked psychological state. And I didn't know that it made such a big resonance in the field, or in beyond the field. Still, the studies, your studies, show that artistic experience of being moved differ from the ordinary ones in being, I mean, artistic, in relation to the biographical one, in being willed by the subject. And you didn't mention this today, if I'm not mistaken, rather than merely occurring to them. Long ago, Coleridge instructed us in this direction when specifying the condition of willing suspension of disbelief as necessary for poetic experience. So that's what you found out. There are other notions about being moved by artistic stimuli that were known to former generations. Already at the turn of the 17th century, as Professor Utkatsu sits here, claimed long ago, the makers of opera, and that's really the followed the rhetoric tradition that you mentioned, that to move the passions of the mind, and you emphasize the mind, that this was a major goal that they formulated for the specific combination of text and music they conjured up, which later on led to the opera. So this particular thing, to move the passions of the mind, necessitates a unique combination of heightened perceptual engagements with the sound, with the voice, with the vocal stimuli, and well-shaped psychological distance. Now, what experimental aesthetics adds to these hard-gained historical insights is the evidence that contemporary art lovers, film goers, for example, this is another thing that, that I read and was not mentioned by you now, still seek to be moved by the movies, they watch. Like in other times, the secured and controlled mode of artistic fiction releases affective reactions deemed positive by its subjects and assessed by research as pro-social. So all the things that you've seen also, the results in terms of all kinds of bodily reactions. Now the second element I refer to, the tension between the normative and the descriptive in art theory and aesthetics, as reflected in lay versus more informed experience of art, is in a way ignored by experimental aesthetics. But by definition, examines reactions of large and average populations, though rather homogeneous ones. True, when painters jointly design perspective as a governing perceptual setting for the pictorial oeuvre, they looked for shared mental frames that will affect every beholder. At the same time, art essentially, or I can also mention that composers, when they conceived tonal harmony, they did the same. They wanted everyone who was reared in the same culture to be able to grasp it, if he doesn't know much about music. At the same time, art essentially searched for perfection, assessed as such mainly by those who acquired related sensibilities and acumen. Despite gearing towards the average, that was a very interesting finding that I collected, Menninghaus and Kao are sensitive to a certain extent to this distinction, when in another study, they juxtapose familiarity and beauty. So we would think that familiarity, for people who are not expert, would be the most important thing which would relate to beauty, but you find out that it's not necessarily so. Beauty could be kind of a separate reaction to these stimuli, and not so much related to always related to familiarity. Historically, the search for novel and non-cliché configurations became a major demand in modern art, thus seemingly going against the grain of Menninghaus and company's presupposition. And yet, one must admit that while repudiating older familiar forms, both popular and highbrow modern art eventually yielded patterns enabling perceptual fluency. So even in that very kind of extreme case of going against the grain of familiarity, you find that nevertheless art goes towards that particular cognitive kind of trait. I've already mentioned intellection, which entailed also aesthetic judgment. The last point I would like to discuss very briefly. In one of the studies mentioned above, the researchers designed their experiments so as to prevent the faculty, or in their language, brain areas that activate cerebral intervention, such as the orbitofrontal cortex, or the OFC as it's called, and succeeded in doing so, which is kind of an achievement. Though for 18th century thinkers, first and foremost among them, Immanuel Kant, deliberate judgment renders art more virtuous, important strands in aesthetics will tell us, and even Kant himself, that the most crucial value judgment in art are basically spontaneous and tacit, however relying on formal learning. Indeed, aesthetic experience entails a variety of options to be willed by subjects according to inclinations and preparation. I would have recommended to Professor Menninghaus and company to account in the research for a variety of populations, rather than that, just for the average one, perhaps you are doing it in other articles, other studies, I don't know, but that's what I read. And as for the bridegroom of this happy event, Chatan HaSimcha, Gabi Motzkin, he seems to possess both. That is, cultivating taste during a lifetime of attending to art, and I think that Emily has also a share in it, it became for him a second nature, to which he would ever add his sharp insights and illuminating reflections. Thank you very much. Okay, so I'm now becoming the moderator, and allow me to sit down.
We're not saying it for amplification, but for recording. I'm actually not going to discuss high art. In the year 1958, I'm going to give you a little anecdote and ask two questions about it. I was 12 years old. That was the last year in which I could get into the movies as a kid for 25 cents. And every Saturday, I would go to what was called a double feature, two movies, and I'd sit through them three times from noon till midnight, and every break I would go out and buy a popcorn. Buying popcorn was a very important part of watching the movies. Now, the reason I'm asking this is because you've mentioned three experiences, which is food, having sex, what was the third one? Oh yes, eating, sex, and poetry. Now, the first question is, if mixing these experiences increases one's pleasure, or if you have to, or after, if you have to experience them separately in order to enjoy their full aesthetic dimension. Good. And the second question that I have is this, that what do you gain or lose through repetition? You, mm-hmm. The point about watching a movie the first time is you have the great fear or goosebump effect of not knowing what will happen. Right. You watch Casablanca, as I have 30 times, you know exactly what will happen, but it does not diminish your enjoyment because you've good. Relived the moment and yeah. something else. Yeah. You have a different experience absolutely watching important. It the sixth time than the first time, but it's no less of an intense experience. So mixture and repetition. Those right. are my two right. questions.
Yeah. Can I respond
yes,
to that?
Yes,
I mean, I...
You want to actually collect more questions?
Well, perhaps, I mean, just for... Because it's
Gabby's
right away respond. Yeah, the micro, is it working? Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. Now, starting with the repetition thing. Now, obviously, I mean, the familiarity is the single most important factor in aesthetic appreciation, you know, for good and for bad things. So that is therefore always controlled for in experimental settings. Now, the child's response is surprisingly resistant to wear out. So, which is why the people bringing their pieces of music, they were asked to start with that reliably elicit chills, and they already know when and where in the trajectory, you know? And the same applies to poems. I mean, because movies are longer in the trajectory, it's perhaps not that easy to recollect those moments, but I can tell you we have already also performed a study using movies. And it does show, I mean, that specifically these strong releases, you know, there's a very good neuroscientist named Pinczower. He literally calls those skin orgasm. And it's not completely misleading because it's a very strong release if you experience those things. They are resistant to wear out. And that's surprising enough, but it's a stable pattern of findings. And it also shows you something about, the focus on these very strong emotional responses is, I first thought, wow, these chills, they're doing way too much about these chills, you know. But once you look into it, it's really intriguingly disclosing with regard to a number of interesting questions. And now getting back, so through repetition, in this case, it deepens the experience. And in fact, first-time exposure used to be the standard paradigm of aesthetic research, because then you can control for reasons for familiarity effects and familiarity. So that means you need to control for it. But on the other hand, we now know that repeated exposure deepens the experience. And in fact, the poetry study I reported, we made use of it. So we made sure each and every participant read those poems three times. So when they were asked to come in again, and so there is a build-up, specifically when it comes to unfamiliar and to some extent demanding pieces of art, you build up your own trajectory, your own familiarity, and to some extent you rehearse your own familiarity upon, you know, rehearing a song, rereading a poem. It's less pronounced with novels because, I mean, people don't read 600 pages novels all the time and again, but some people actually do. But films are a good example. So the 90 minutes or 60 minutes format, and people get just the very same, moments in time. So I can tell you what your question is very pertinent, because it's precisely so attractive about these responses that they are resistant to wear out, which is amazing. You know, that's one thing where our findings depart from classical assumptions, in that Lessing and Kant, you know, made a strong claim that aesthetic pleasure should not reach peak level, because peak level could lead to satiation effects, like having eaten too much, then it's done. Or, and to some extent, the findings suggest that you can go through multiple peaks. So it's a multiple, you know, in your favorite piece of music, you go to multiple minor skin orgasms, so to speak. And that's, I mean, one needs to swallow that. But there is something about those findings that is, I mean, if you bring young people to the lab, they right away understand what the whole thing is about. I have to say, this was not on my mind map at all. I had no idea about these things, and now I'm learning that it's really something to be found out through these paradigms.
But still, there is a concept of aesthetic fatigue. We all know that there is a moment in
right.
which we...
There is fatigue. I mean, there is certainly fatigue, but it depends very much on your individual preferences. And as I said, the research on musical chills, music-induced chills, I mean, could not find any overarching pattern between the responses of the individual participants. They only found the chill response was the same, but they could not predict when it would happen. So to some extent, apparently in our case, we can better make predictions as to specific points in time in the reading where the likelihood of chills to occur increases. I mean, as I said, this was the first study, so we are only in the beginning. We are now doing it with films.
What about the mixture now, having two experiences at the same time? Like eating and watching?
Yeah. Oh, no idea. I have no idea. I mean, so.
Okay, so
okay.
And then four. Okay.
So. This was very impressive, and it's kind of ironic that 2 months club people have come to Jerusalem.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you both for lecture and commentary. And I said it's kind of ironic that two Max Planck people have come to Jerusalem to learn about each other's work. Maybe we have to do something about the Max Planck Society there. We're learning from. I have actually two questions. You mentioned Walter Benjamin and several others thinkers about modern aesthetics. So that would be my first question, which role does an aesthetics of resistance, an anti-Aristotelian aesthetics, as we find it in Brecht's epic theater, in Benjamin's reflection on it, in Peter Weiss' aesthetic of resistance, which role does it play with regard to this, more brain science-oriented researches on aesthetics? And connected to this, my question is about widening the realm of psychosocial experiences, you know, focusing on poetry, music, film, art in this very definite Western bourgeois sense, of course, narrows the realm of psychosocial experiences with which you might be able to compare the experiences that you are recording. And let me just give two indications. One is obvious in this context here, you know, taking up Gabi's point about repetition. So we think about all kinds of ritualization. So ritualization is a basic phenomenon of religions. It's a basic phenomenon of many psychic deformations, as it were. So, which brings me again to Freud and a parallel, at least, that I have noticed between your linguistic use of the notion of parallelism, the Jacobson idea of parallelism, and the psychoanalytic notion then, which made a lot of career also in literary theory, of overdetermination. Mm-hmm. And that brings us to the interpretation of dreams and other psychosocial phenomena, as I said. So I would be grateful if you could comment on these two.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for a very rich and interesting lecture. I have many questions, but I'll ask only one. I know something about brain studies in music and vision. And I'm sure you know it all, noise, aesthetics that Zaki created and these groups. But anyway, I want to say something about your findings and ask you a question about it. From what I understand about the studies that I'm familiar with, that salient features, parallelism, repetition, densities, and omissions that are filled in through expectations are findings both about vision and also about sound, music. Now, nowadays, one talks a great deal about the exchange among senses. You know, that a sense can replace another sense. I'm sure you are also familiar with that, having heard your lecture. I'm sure you're familiar with all of that. And of course, about the relevance of past theories to present questions that the mind addresses the brain. But given the exchange among senses, which nowadays is studied greatly, why should it be surprising that the findings, both about vision and about sound, and especially when you emphasize that people prefer hearing rather than reading, why should one not take notice now of the exchange among senses more than studying separately each single item which creates a repetition? Mm-hmm. Not to speak of certain aspects, like certainly true for music, that you have to possess music by meaning. Music doesn't have meaning unto itself for the simple reason that it just has a syntax without the semantics. But if you look at history, you know how it was possessed. And then you also discover the role of movement, because emotions, people have talked about emotions time and again as movement, and all of rhythm and things, these are movements. This is unfolding in time. And therefore, there's an interrelationship between all of this. And therefore, I find particularly interesting not the findings, but the way you test them. I mean, the experiment, setting up the experiment. Mm-hmm. So I want you to comment on something about the exchange among senses. Okay.
Thank you.
So, first of all,
That's quite a number, sorry.
Yes. Okay, so we're limited to five? That's it? Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. just like the last speaker here, and the speaker, and the comment, I am also particularly thrilled by the attempt of the neurocorrelate of the emotions and the aesthetic emotions generated now by poetry. Now, as Ruth emphasized, and I would like to elaborate a little bit on that, you mentioned also that similar experiments are performed in music, on the auditory system, and much broader and old and slightly older effort was generated by this pioneering book by the neuroanatomist Semir Zeki on neuroaesthetics on the visual system. And there, the main point in that book, the main idea in that book is that artists, sometimes consciously, but mostly unconsciously, are in a way brain researchers. They experiment with the brain. Some of them, like Jackson Pollock and Surrealist and the Pointillist, did it consciously. Most of them don't. Now, it is also intriguing to think that in a way poets are also brain researchers. Of course, you may elaborate on this kind of notion. You particularly emphasized one very well-known and researched phenomenon of the neural response system, and that's the surprise effect. In the auditory system, you know, neurons adapt and then suddenly a surprise happens. And maybe poets experiment with that to a large extent. Of course, with poetry, there is a great difficulty. There you have a very well-defined auditory system, visual system. Here, everything is involved. And the last comment, which I would like you presented, you had a slide on brain imaging. You didn't want to interpret it. I'm not going to interpret it, but one thing can be said about that slide, and it's particularly interesting to emphasize it in an audience like that, because poets still talk about the left side of the brain and the right side of the brain. If there was anything visible on your slide here, that everything happens everywhere.
Right.
Exactly. So there is no left side and no right side. Thank you.
Right, thank you. Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, so back to Jan. And yes. Okay. Okay.
Yes, thank you very much. So I wanted to ask you, so to what extent understanding a poem, so getting the, you know, the very deep content can affect us in a way that we are emotionally moved? Because it seems that the features you analyzed are more, I mean, they are still very important, like the prosody, the musical verse, and so, but they are more, I mean, it seems that we have to take into account also other aspects when we want to be emotionally engaged or moved. So it seems that you showed us findings on a perceptual level. And then, of course, we have to discuss about what we mean with perception here and if there are some concepts which are involved in, you know, in getting also this perceptual level features. But then it seems that we have to work more on the cognition level. And so if you take like Eugenio Montale's poem, for example, we can appreciate the musicality of a verse, and we can say that, I mean, they're very beautiful for us, but in order to get the deep meaning of it, we need to do some sort of effort, and we need time to get it, which doesn't really relate to the familiarity thing. It's something different that I have in mind. So I was wondering whether there's a distinction between a cognition level and a perception level.
Thank you.
The tremendous progress from I.R. Richards' Reader's Response. Mm-hmm. It's really an amazing development since that period. So I have two very quick questions. I have 10, but I have some compassion for the audience. The first one is, you mentioned memorability and comprehensibility. These are major features of oral culture success. of rhetoric in oral culture. Memorability, and we know what memorability and comprehensibility did from the works of Jack Goody, Michael Cole, and Walter Ong, and the others. However, my question is, to what extent we can say that this standards of persuasiveness, which were evolved over centuries in oral culture, actually carried over to texts without residue, without differences. Second question is this. There is a lot of literature today on the phenomena of imaginative resistance of readers. For example, to a novel where there is a certain description of pornography, there is a negative response or a skipping over and so on. So when you introduce your fourth category of the poetic imagination or imagination, how can you discern the difference between responses to poetic imagination to responses to rhetorical features like recurrent parallels?
So the last two questions, and then you will have to somehow summarize it. Yes.
Yes. Now, what you have said about a mixture of predictability and surprise, it's in as a it's basic features that you are testing. And have you tried comparing reactions to similar composers, like, say, Mozart and Hummel, and seeing the reactions to Mozart would certainly be stronger and perhaps at different points than to Hummel, which would tell us something not only about the neural reactions to these things, but also about why Mozart is a greater composer than Hummel. This is, I mean, as a analysis of explaining the aesthetics superiority of Mozart. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Last question, Antonis?
Thanks for the presentation. Short question. Could say something regarding actually the angle, and at the end of the day, the claim of this sort of studies. So you're actually saying that we don't need poetics anymore because they can be reduced to neuroscience, like, or it's like understanding poetics in a better way, like. Because like this sort of studies, you refer to Kant, Schlegel, Aristotle. Okay, so what's the connection between, so to say, traditional poetics in terms of claim and this? Thanks.
Okay, that's it. Okay, good. So perhaps I start with the final question. I mean, obviously, neuroscience does not entail any hypothesis regarding aesthetic effects of whatever artworks or fashion or whatever. So neuroscience by itself has a increasingly profound understanding of how the brain works. And so you need to bring together the body of hypotheses you know, or I mean that's already been developed in the tradition and that is consistently be revised. But by itself, neuroscience can't do the job. So that's I don't see that any potential. In fact, if you can see on an attempts to simply measure things that they don't lead you anywhere. If you do not have a clear sense of the aesthetic object and the and some anticipations of response features that for the time being you still get through recourse to the tradition. So there is a sustained effort has been made in the tradition to arrive at relevant categories, and we heavily rely on those. So it's not just put someone in the scanner, it doesn't tell you very much. Regarding musicians, poems, and I mean, first of all, let me say, I hope I have, sufficient time to arrive at a response, a profound scientific response to many of those questions. And I should say, we are fully aware of the fact that what we are doing captures only a portion. It's, I'm not saying this is it, right? And but we have also, I mean, started to look into, for instance, the poems that have been set to music versus those that have not. And that was really a finding which I personally find very thrilling. You know, so we measured, I mean, we simply applied our statistical measure, I mean, not the one I presented here, but the one we have developed for acoustic parameters, to acoustic renditions of poems, and those who scored higher were far more likely to have been set to music by musicians. So as a result, I would really subscribe to the notion that the musicians have an intuitive sense of these things, of underlying features in poetry that make them more musical. And I mean, it's not necessarily surprising, but we are quite happy of having arrived at a way to really show it in a way. So to some extent, it's often that you had the anticipation one way or another, but it's very difficult to really show this is what is actually happening. Now, regarding oral versus written culture, I think poetry aims at memorability even in their purely written version. So to some extent, it's more memorable. It's because it's a shorter version. No one learns a novel by heart. I mean, that's unheard of, at least as far as I know. So it depends on the length of the art form. And you know, the difference is not completely, not that pronounced, because there is good evidence now that people upon reading build up an auditory representation in their brain. So silent reading is kind of a sub-acoustic representation of the acoustic structure. So a good reader of poetry to some extent supplements the acoustic dimensions. Very difficult though to investigate but I think the it's not a clear-cut division between the two modalities. Understanding of poems. Again, I perfectly agree with what you said. So we have more studies on the understanding aspect in the line. So the model actually disregarded that. So it said, because we use the very same poems, we believe that the content should be more or less the same, so we can separate and dissociate the factor of diction. So in rhetoric, the factor of diction is a tiny factor. I mean, just using Aristotle, he said the first thing is to invent a plot, a storyline or whatever, or the content, then the disposition, it's the major composition, and finally putting that to words, that's diction. So, I mean, we would necessarily, I mean, following the tradition, we would need to develop tools for all aspects. So for the time being, I focus on diction because that is most neglected. So in linguistics, it doesn't tell you anything about it. And literary scholarship is very much devoted to cultural interpretations and content interpretation. So, I mean, that is my only explanation for that. Regarding Zeki has not looked into emotional dimensions of the, he's exclusively looked into correlates of beauty judgment and not even of other judgments. You know, it's, that's a very limited thing. And so the stuff we look into, therefore, I mean, the chill stuff is very separate, completely separate from the Zeki research. I'm not saying anything bad about Zeki's research, but in some cases he is too limited by having no other category than beauty. And aesthetics is just not only the science of beauty. I mean, that specifically applies to literature. I mean, within literature, poetry is most closely related to beauty expectations. But novels are typically not necessarily as beautiful. Well, there are beautiful novels, and maybe even slightly kitschy or whatever, you know. But the expectation of readers is they be suspenseful, interesting, or whatever. And so things can be suspenseful, things can be interesting without necessarily being beautiful. I mean, there's a whole variety of aesthetic dimensions, so we have developed a table. It's overwhelmingly complex. And Zicke only sees beauty. And that is a very strong limitation. So, and he disregards emotional responses. So in this regard, I think we really make a substantial move forward in this field. There was the multi-sensory Well, you know, I perfectly agree. To some extent, we are experts in multi-sensory integration, which is why movies are to some extent the most natural thing for us to see. So because that is exactly what we are best in. Integrate visual input, auditory input, everything. And well, now, I think though, I mean, if you first of all, I mean, my focus is literature, right? So I'm, and even though I'm always doing lots of stuff on film. So in film is the part where we have the multi-sensor integration, but then it's really difficult to say, I mean, to tell apart the effects and the cause, because you have such a rich signal. The good thing about focusing on poetry only is you have a clear-cut, I mean, mono-dimensional thing. So from an experimental point of view, this is, I mean, quite satisfying, but I see the point. You know, it's important.
The findings, your findings, the interesting thing is that your findings are similar to the findings of also those
okay.
And that is interesting, not to speak about emotions.
It is true. And as I said, we have already a parallel study on films, and we do find parallel things.
This the questions of your
Absolutely. I make my my way from the end to the beginning, and
yes, exactly.
I think Walter Benjamin and Brecht, I do not see any reason not to test those hypotheses. I mean, they have clear-cut hypotheses about Verfremdung, about, you know, alienation. Obviously, I mean, they are very much dependent on the cultural context to some extent, so it may be difficult to replicate them, but it, you know, if you would, you know, ask people who like to read Brecht, for instance, I mean, that is perfectly doable, and would certainly, again, be another way to enrich the narrow focus so many of these studies suffer from. You know, it's, I would simply say, I personally would be very much interested in that type of thing. Two, we have actually carried out one single study on Kurzschwitters Ursonate. Ursonate, I mean, it's from the 1920s. And there we have applied a very rich, you know, set of methods and everything, but that would take another entire lecture to report it, and that has some elements in it that you might expect. And now, finally, I mean, getting back to your remarks.
Kind of really.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Having so
I think you're, but
maybe the people are starting to be
because you are the very frame of this entire. Right. So I felt it's nicer to get back to that at the end. I mean, you have offered very rich comments, and so I apologize for not being able to respond to everything. I think, but one very important thing is the concern with the means that you report, and the individual responses, and I think I very much share this concern. And you know, depending on the question you have, you look for individual differences, and you always have a set of individual differences, and typically you also collect data on the persons, so their age, their whatever sex, their level of education, even income level is quite, you know, usual to ask for. So you could invariably almost always use the same data set for analyzing them depending on differences in persons. And we have already done that on a number of occasions. For instance, sad movies. Sadly moving movies, the prediction was from some part that would be something women would be more likely to enjoy because they're more empathetic and whatever. You know, the classical assumption, that's more for women, and men prefer horror movies. That's to some extent the opposite end. And in fact, in our study, we did not find any gender difference. Mm-hmm. So I mean, those who came to the lab, both male and female students, responded the same way to emotionally moving films of the sad nature. Again, so we could not replicate findings that pointed in another direction. But we also very much looking at these individual differences level. In many people believe it's undoable, but it's only doable using scientific means, mm-hmm. because the individual would escape one's attention. And something we will only set up now is a focus on ontogenetic research. So, I mean, so life, the importance of the life trajectory for your aesthetic preferences. Mm-hmm. That is mm-hmm. a very intriguing, very rich, very important field of research. We will set up a kindergarten, actually, and literally entire kindergarten in Frankfurt. So to start that, we start on kids from age 6 to 16. You know, there's one thing is already almost predictable. So preliminary evidence suggests that listening to music, seeing movies, reading peaks by the age of 12 through 16 or something. So that's a very rich age to learn something about. And though the preferences you establish during that time, I mean, are typically well maintained across your later life. Only experts really significantly expand their range of aesthetic, experiences after turning 30. So, I mean, that's something we were really looking to. And one thing I personally would like to learn more about is that the peak activity in terms of reading, listening to music is during sexual maturation. So, is that a coincidence, or is there anything, that kind of reading poetry, so can also feed into imaginations of whatever, and so that's something where we know very little about this far, and we really want to learn more about that in the years to come. And I'm tempted to say, I don't want to give another lecture here. So I'm very grateful for all the questions you had, and thank you very much for your
Thank you.